Good morning, everyone. My name's Tom Farr. I'm the director of the Religious Freedom Project here at the Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs. And I want to welcome all of you. It is quite an honor and a privilege to have such a distinguished group here in this room to discuss what for me is going to be a very fun topic. I don't know, some of you are so expert on this. I don't know if you can call your work fun. I hope you can. The title of our standing seminar, a term which we'll explain to you in a bit more detail in a minute, is Religion, Human Personhood, Culture, and Society. And this is part of a project which we call the Religious Freedom Project, which has a larger title, that is to say, Religion is Intrinsic to Human Experience. That comes off the lips very quickly, but we had to negotiate that title for several months. My initial thought was religion is intrinsic to human nature, but I got in a lot of trouble with the idea that there's such a thing as human nature. We found consensus on the proposition that there is such a thing as human experience. So this is, as I say, one aspect of a number of targeted areas that we have in our Religious Freedom Project. Now, there are a number of reasons for being interested in the subject of our discussion today. The title of Chris Smith's paper is Are Humans Naturally Religious? I suspect for many, if not all of you, this is something, and in fact I know for many of you, you've written about. It's an area of your scholarly expertise, and that's why you're here. For me, this one of the reasons this is going to be fun is because I'm a former American diplomat, and I haven't made a lifetime of study of this, but I've been involved in the issue of religious freedom as a matter of American foreign policy. And this is, in fact, the motive force for me in the project that brings us together here today. A couple of years ago, we decided we wanted to have at the Berkeley Center a project on religious freedom. Prior to that, I had been running a project on religion and U.S. foreign policy and had taught some courses and was running a number of seminars and symposia on that subject. Little did we know at the time how salient this issue would continue to be, although I confess I suspected that it would always be salient, but it seems to be more and more rather than less and less salient. It's a contested issue, religious freedom. That's one thing that I've learned not only in traveling the world to discuss it with people who persecute on the basis of religion, but with people who support it in principle but disagree over what it means. So in defining this broad project, this religious freedom project, as you're going to see when you hear from my colleague Tim Shaw in just a minute, we sort of carved it up into bite-sized areas that we would look at. For example, one of our topics is the relationship or the correlations, if any, between religious freedom and other social, political, economic goods, or relationships between religious freedom and religion-related terrorism. And in fact, we're going to have on March 16th a public symposium here at Georgetown on the very subject. Some in this room will participate in that. And we invite you to go to our website and look at the propaganda in your sleeves there, and you can see the conferences that are coming. But this topic is of special interest to me because of really the subject that we're going to talk about today, that Chris Smith is going to lead us and Phil Zuckerman is going to respond on, and that is the extent to which we can say religion is natural to human beings. It's part of the makeup. Now, for me, the so what question is, so what? If it is, maybe, you know, it's like my part of my DNA, my wife tells me, is orneriness. And to say that orneriness is natural to human beings is not to say that we shouldn't try to get rid of it. One could say the same for religion. So if, however, in my view, religion is natural to human beings, then that is one more reason to advocate for religious freedom, still recognizing that even if this is true, that the concept remains highly contested. So With that bit of background, let me simply say that this is a project funded by the Templeton Foundation. Let me express my thanks, as I always do, for the generosity of Templeton. This is an expert seminar that is designed to produce at the end of the day, which will be the day, the end of the day will be sometime in 2013, a scholarly volume on the broad subject of religion as intrinsic to human experience, and to connect it in ways that we have not yet completely explored to the issue of religious freedom. And that's what we're in the midst of today. Let me introduce the brains behind this operation, my associate director, Tim Shaw, who will be leading us through our discussion today, and the guy who's really the brains behind this operation, Kyle, where are you? Kyle Vandermeulen, the person without whom not, so to speak, makes the trains and the microphones and everything else run on time. The bathrooms, to get to the most important part of our discussion, are straight down the way here. So we want to be very informal. We want you to feel relaxed so that, you know, if you need to go down the hall, please do so. Get something to drink as you do so. This is a discussion among colleagues. It's not a set piece. We have had set piece discussions in this room. I can remember the Chinese State Administration for Religious Affairs sitting right there and right where Jose Casanova is. Ye Xiao Wen, who was the head thug in that operation. And we sat over here, and it was very formal and stiff. Let's don't do it that way. So, Tim, take it from here.
Very good. Thanks very much, Tom. And thank you all very much. Thank you, Christian Smith and Phil Zuckerman and everyone here who has agreed to be part of this seminar. When one has a group such as this, a group of scholars such as this, as august and eminent as this, the only rational and reasonable thing for me to do is to shut up and get out of the way as soon as possible. But I wanted to just set the stage very, very briefly. It would be reasonable to wonder why a project on religious freedom would convene a group like this to talk about a topic such as this. Normally, I think we have a tendency to think of religious freedom as a relatively narrow legal or juridical or political issue about which there may be some controversy, but about which we have in the United States a great deal of consensus. Why should we talk about philosophical anthropology? Why should we talk about the nature of the person? Or in the nature of society. And the premise of doing that, the premise behind doing that, our view is that, in fact, it's not possible to separate fundamental questions about the nature of the person, the nature of religion, the status of religion, the value of religion, from questions about the nature, status, value of religious freedom. They're simply not separable. One can't, in fact, have a deontological or value-free or non-substantive or merely legal or political conception of religious freedom, that any conception of religious freedom presupposes some understanding of what is the nature of religion and what is the connection between religion, however it's understood, and human persons and human societies. But how should we think about what is the status of religion? And the nature of religion vis-a-vis human personhood and human society. We used to not be very troubled, I think, as scholars about this set of questions, let me say. This morning I pulled almost at random from my bookshelf, a book probably many of you have seen, a collection of very important essays in the mid-1980s about sacred and secular. And let me just read two sentences from the very first page, the introduction by Philip Hammond. So much has the secularization thesis dominated the social scientific study of religious change that it is now conventional wisdom. Even today, scholars do not and probably cannot doubt the essential truth of the thesis. In other words, not that long ago, in 1985, it was assumed that one could not, note what Philip Hammond says, one could not doubt the essential truth of the secularization thesis, which is, as all of us know, that modernity, in some sense, in some way, through some set of mechanisms, makes the decline of religion, in some sense, eventually inevitable. That really was the conventional wisdom. And so having a discussion about whether religion is natural to human beings, I think, would have been inconceivable at a respectable university like Georgetown, even a very short time ago. But here we are, not that long after that book was published, and it's now possible to have a much broader discussion about the status, the nature of religion and its relationship to human society and human cultures, because we now take for granted that religion has a great deal more vitality in the modern world than many, many, many people assumed would be the case. And yet at the same time, it's indisputable that in some places, to some extent, secularization has occurred. That also seems undeniable, as Phil Zuckerman has written very, very powerfully, and as other scholars like Steve Bruce and others have documented. So this raises very challenging and difficult questions. If it's true that secularization isn't undisputed conventional wisdom, but if it's also true that secularization sometimes does in fact occur, what does that say about the nature or the status of religion vis-a-vis human persons and human societies? And then what does that say about the status of religious freedom? Is religion so natural and embedded in human beings that it demands a certain level of respect, or is it in fact something that actually is relatively artificial, something that's malleable, something that people can turn on and turn off, such that religious freedom might look rather different as a value? As Tom said, we've wanted to approach the question of religious freedom along the lines of what I've been saying in the broadest possible interdisciplinary terms, not merely as a narrow policy or political or legal issue, but we wanted to ask the broadest possible questions about the status, role, scope of religious freedom. And again, we feel we can't do that unless we ask the kinds of questions we're asking today. And this seminar has, in fact, been part of a series of seminars on this issue that Tom pointed to of whether religion is intrinsic to human experience. We've had outstanding seminars, much like this one, with experts much like yourselves, discussing, is religion natural to or embedded in human cognition and psychology? We've had a session on whether religion is integral to human health and happiness. We will have sessions, we'll have a session in September with Alvin Plantinga on whether religion is intrinsic to human rationality. So we are trying to have as broad a discussion, but also as interdisciplinary discussion as possible. You'll see around the room here, not just sociologists like Chris and Phil, but also philosophers and others, and that's intended. We want to ask these questions from the standpoint of a variety of disciplines. So with that, let me shut up and get out of the way. You're not here to listen to me, but I did want to give you some context for why we're having this conversation under the auspices of the Religious Freedom Project. The agenda today is very, very, very simple. We will hear from Chris. All of you would have received Chris's paper, but to refresh, Chris will highlight some of the aspects of the paper. And then at the end of the morning, we'll hear from Phil Zuckerman, who has seen Chris's paper and will have a lot to say about it, I know. And then we'll break for lunch. And in the afternoon, we will talk. There's no very, very rigid agenda in the afternoon. We're anxious to hear from you expansively and energetically, talk about the issues that I've raised. In the first part of the afternoon, we will try to focus on the body of Chris's paper, the arguments he lays out concerning religion and human personhood. Towards the end of the afternoon, we'll have a more focused discussion on the implications of these issues for religious freedom specifically. I'll just say one more thing, and that is that it's clear if you just look at the headlines that religious freedom is very much in the news. So In some ways, we could not have imagined that the issues of religious freedom would be as timely and as urgent, as important as they have become, not just on the international front, but also on the domestic front, with the controversy concerning the healthcare mandate, with a whole range of issues. Religious liberty is very much in the forefront. So it would be good to begin to talk about what the implications of what we're discussing today might be for issues of that sort as well. So without further ado, I'm going to, yes, Tom.
Tim, it might just be useful for us to go around
yes,
the room
yeah,
and everyone
you.
Introduce themselves. If I might begin and just say a word about yourselves, we'll begin with Byron. But if I might just introduce our scholars team myself, these are, if you look at our brochure, you'll see that part of the Religious Freedom Project is a team of international scholars that are, many of whom are here today. Not all of them could make it. And I just would like to have the opportunity to introduce them. First, Jose Casanova, who is a professor of sociology here, of course, at Georgetown. Professor David Novak at the University of Toronto. David, we're so glad you could make it. Dan Philpott, our true IR specialist from Notre Dame. Dan, to come here from South Bend, as Chris Smith knows, is it's a lot easier to come from Chapel Hill, isn't it, than from South Bend. So thank you for coming. Will N. Bowden at the University of Texas, sort of our national security expert and a historian. So we get a real twofer from Will. Thanks for coming all the way from Texas. And, of course, Roger Trigg, our international guest, who is a philosopher at Oxford and who will be working with us. He's on our scholars team. He's also working with us on a very important conference we're going to have at Magdalen College, Oxford, in April on emerging conflicts in the United States and Europe between religious freedom and other rights claims, such as gay marriage. So that should be a lot of fun. We're going to have, and you'll see a description of this. So Byron, if you would begin, and let's just go quickly around the room, and let's, and then we'll end up by people on in the back as well.
Hello, I'm Byron Johnson from Baylor University. I direct the Institute for Studies of War. I'm Ray Martin, from College. As far as this morning's concerned, I've done a lot of work over the years in the intersection between philosophy and social theory, philosophy and social science. So that's a big role.
Well, say something about your new book, too, Roger.
Oh, well, I'm always passionate. It's got a lot of media attention in Europe. So it's called Equality, Freedom, and Religion, and it's about the clash between religious freedom and equality. So it's a hot issue.
And we're hosting a launch of Roger's book here at the Berkeley Center on Monday afternoon. Anyone is still in town?
Oxford University Press, all good booksellers.
I'm Will N. Bowden, and I'm just introduced by Tom.
Margaret Hull, sociology of Jewish.
I'm Kyle Vandermeulen, the project associate for the Religious Freedom Project.
Marjorie Mandelstam-Balzer, anthropology at Georgetown.
Dan Philpott, also introduced.
David Novak, your studies at the University of Toronto, as long as we're plugging books. You had a wonderful book launch for my book, In Defense of Religious Liberty, which I thank you.
Terrific.
John Shook, philosophy, latecomer invite of Phil Zuckerman, affiliated with George Mason and also the University of Buffalo. I'm also on the staffs of two major secular organizations, the Center for Inquiry and the American Humanist Association.
I'm the director of the American Center at Bell Top.
Margarita Moody in sociology at the University of North
Has said that this is a historical first for Georgetown, and so many prominent sociologists reunite as gifts.
I'm working in sociology, studying the gift.
Nancy Ammerman, sociology and school theology at Boston University.
Thank you all very much.
Can we get the
people? Oh, yes, forgive me, sorry. Yeah.
My name is Becky Sue. I'm an assistant professor in the sociology department here at Georgetown.
I'm Simon Bolinda from Holland, University of Browning, and I'm a fellow here at the Berkeley Center, and I'm writing this station on religion and international relations theory.
Michael Cromarty, Ethics and Public Policy Center here in Washington.
Go ahead, Jesse.
Yeah.
Senior from Kelvin College and an intern at Berkeley Center.
Bill McDonald, Sociology Department at Georgetown University. This is not my field. I'm just here to see what Jose does when he's away.
And Michael Wood, who has to do with the World Faith Development Dialogue here at the Berkeley Center.
Yes, indeed. Welcome to all of you. Well, without further ado, let's turn to our keynote speaker, really, today, and paper presenter, Christian Smith. It would take a long time to give a proper introduction to Chris, so I'm not going to even try to do that. I'll just say that the range of Chris's work, as you know, I think all of you know, is truly extraordinary. He's done groundbreaking work on a whole range of empirical and theoretical issues in the sociology of religion, done outstanding work on American evangelicalism, on Latin American religion, on secularization in America, and then more recently has done extraordinary theoretical work trying to offer a new basis for proceeding in the social sciences, a new kind of philosophical anthropology, as it were, to ground social scientific inquiry. Began this project with a book called Moral Believing Animals, which I'm proud to say I taught in a class I taught last semester, and students really enjoyed the book and understood it, and Chris writes powerfully but also very accessibly, and has followed that book up with a recent book on What is a Person? And it's these themes, the theoretical themes of Chris's more recent work that we'll, of course, we'll be talking about today. So without further ado, Chris, thank you for being here.
Thank you very much. While we're plugging books, I'm going to plug Dan and Timothy's book, God's Century, which I just read on the train up from North Carolina yesterday, and I thought it was a great book, and I'm going to use it in my intro to sociology class in the fall. In addition to Nancy's book, Everyday Religion, which is also a fantastic book. So lots of,
there's a lot of
good books happen.
There's a lot of love in
the room. A lot of good, you got to get as much of that up front as you can.
Has anyone here written a bad book?
Well, thank you, Thomas and Timothy, for inviting me. I actually normally do not accept invitations that require writing an original anything. So this is unusual for me, but there's a reason why I accepted this one, and it goes back to a book review of Phil's book. Some time ago, a junior sociologist named Ryan Cragen wrote a book review of Phil's book and said, this is a great book, and it shows that the views of Chris Smith and Andrew Greeley and Rodney Stark et al. Are wrong. And I thought, I didn't know that chose me to be wrong. And so I, you know, wrote Ryan and Phil and said, I'm not sure that, you know, you've really adequately. And then Ryan, I think, got a little nervous and said, well, that's what Phil says in his book. So, Rod Stark was somehow involved in this conversation. And in typical form, he said something quite rude, I thought, about Phil's methods. And so it was an interesting go-around that wasn't resolved and sort of up in the air. But I left the email conversation thinking, you know, the truth is that it'd be good for somebody to sort out more clearly the long train of thinking about are people naturally religious. But I never got to it. And then in due time, we left on friendly terms from the email exchange, but I'm not sure everyone else did. Sometime after, I got an email from Timothy saying, hey, we want to do this, and would you write? So I thought, well, this is actually a good opportunity to put together some of my thoughts, such as they are, on something that I was thinking I would want to do anyway. So that's what gets me here. I mean, not that I am not happy to be with you all. It's an amazing opportunity, but there's a very specific history, going back to a book review, and I don't know what journal, that set me up for this. Okay, so are humans naturally religious? The conclusion, if you've read the paper, is essentially yes, but in a way that's more complicated than, as I understand it, has been typically understood or argued. And as most of these things turn out to be, the answer is yes, but it depends. It depends on how you conceptualize religion, naturally, all these sort of things. And so I come down on the yes side, but I want to do that in a way that completely honors the empirical reality, realities, some of which Phil, I think, nicely captures in his book. So that's where I want to go. So humans are naturally religious, or by nature religious, as a matter of real natural potentiality, capacity, and tendency. Those are the key words here. While at the same time acknowledging that many humans and even some cultures are not particularly religious at all. So I try to start with the evidence, and I try to acknowledge that the evidence is ambiguous. On the one hand, there are plenty of individual people and some cultures that are, on the surface of it at least, apparently not religious by most or any definition that we normally use to understand what religion is. And they seem functional, their lives are not breaking down, the societies seem functional, people seem happy. It doesn't seem that human life is dramatically compromised, or maybe compromised at all. Possibly even advanced in some ways by being not religious. That just seems to be an empirical fact. So any claims that humans are naturally religious need to take that somehow into account. It's also the case, however, that intentional state attempts to get rid of religion have not succeeded. At least absolutely succeeded. They've succeeded in perhaps repressing the number of people who consider themselves to be religious or who say they believe in God. But religion seems inextinguishable, I think it's also fair to say, empirically. At least the evidence we have on hand. Of course, none of us knows what's going to happen in the future, but so far we have the best reason to think that that's also the case. It's also the case that it seems to me empirically that how religious people and peoples are is highly sort of path dependent, contingent on historical particularities of war and regimes and as Dan and Timothy will say, their political theology interacting with, you know, the relationship of religion and the state. There's a lot of cultural backgrounds and trajectories. There's a lot of contingency and accident and path dependency that goes into actual outcomes in particular cases. And so any argument that humans are naturally religious also needs to take into account that there isn't just this if A, then B, or here's a covering law, or here's a general tendency that will be applicable all the way around one way or another. So if that's the background sort of empirical evidence, the best that we have, how could we come down on one side or the other of any argument that's saying people are naturally or not naturally religious? Well, the approach that I take, and of course there are many approaches, but the approach that I take to try to make best sense of this for myself is bringing together a meta theory of science and social science, or philosophy of science and social science, called critical realism, which I'm committed to, and I have a few allies here that are committed to it too. So if I get in trouble, I'll throw the ball to them. A certain approach to understanding religion that I get from Martin Riesebrot's recent book, The Promise of Salvation, which some of us were not too long ago in Miami Beach arguing about. So this meeting is actually for some of us had a precursor sort of warm up. And a certain understanding of what is by nature, or what nature is, that I draw from critical realism, although I hope is accessible to people who aren't critical realists. The key ideas, let's start off with religion. By religion, is page 9 of my paper. Following Martin Riesebrot, I mean a complex of practices that are based on the premise of the existence of superhuman powers, whether personal or impersonal, that are generally invisible. Now, I don't think that there is one right definition of religion. I mean, these are all more or less capture what's going on. But for my money, this is this one captures. It gives us the cognitive, the conceptual way of understanding what we're talking about that it's best. For one thing, Riesebrot focuses us on practices. So the primary thing is behaviors that people are engaging in that are meaningful, rather than starting with abstract belief systems, which gets us into all sorts of trouble. I won't explain that, but Martin does a very nice job with it. But basically, if you start off with abstract belief systems, then you become susceptible to a lot of the recent critiques that religion doesn't really exist, that it's a modern Western invention that's been imposed on people in the Indian subcontinent who had no idea they were religious until colonialism, etc. Martin, I think, effectively argues if you focus on practices rather than abstract belief systems, people have been practicing this thing that, fine, we have called it religion. We've invented Hinduism. What we've invented has been going on as a set of practices. And so it deals with that kind of challenge. Based on the premise of existence of superhuman powers, I'm comfortable with either superhuman or super empirical. I haven't sorted that all the way through, but it's superhuman intentionally, not transcendent, because some religions understand the superhuman to be immanent, not transcendent. And it's not supernatural, because some religions understand what's super empirical or superhuman as being part of nature. It's not that supernatural itself comes out of a very particular worldview in which there's nature and then something is super to that. But in certain religious traditions, it's just part of nature that the superhuman powers exist. So that's why superhuman, every time I read that, I think of, you know, Superman and Spider-Man and so on. But that's not the intention is much more broad than that. Personal or impersonal, but generally invisible. So that's the definition of religion that I'm working with here. Now, back to critical realism. Obviously, I'm not going to run critical realism all the way up the flagpole and down again. But the idea here, there's a lot going on here, but the main idea here that I'm using from critical realism is in contrast with what I would call positivist empiricism, which really focuses on the only thing we can really talk about are surface events, observable empirical events and the associations between them. And so if we took a positivist empiricist approach to this, we would be thinking along the lines of how many cases of humanity do we have, and in how many of those cases do we empirically observe something that we call religious, and then there's some kind of surface level association, an observable association, and that will therefore tell us whether people are naturally religious or not. Although if you're a real good positivist empiricist, you don't even like the language of natural at all, because that assumes some kind of metaphysical position, which positivist empiricism generally would prefer to avoid at the very least, even if it's not anti-realist. So a critical realist point of view basically encourages us to think of science as about understanding things that we can't observe directly. We have a surface apprehension of things, but what we really finally want to understand is what's going on at a deep level, what's going on beneath the surface. That is, things like causes. And so it'll take Hume seriously to a certain extent on causation and say, yeah, but the reason you can't get any further is because you started off as an empiricist and therefore you've limited yourself to, if we say, you know, causes are deep, causes are real, causes are not directly observable. We can observe the effects of causes, but we have to put together empirical observations of associations and so on and think about them as hard as we can and study things as well as we can to create theoretical conceptual models of what's going on that we can't directly observe that basically tells us as best as we can get what is true about what is real. That's what critical realism is interested in. Another way to describe what the position critical realism takes is a combination of three things: ontological realism, epistemological perspectivalism, and judgmental rationalism, meaning, and other views that it's skeptical of or argues against will switch those things around. But the critical realist is that there, ontologically, there is a reality that exists. Much of the reality is independent of our consciousness of it. It's not entirely mind-dependent. Certain parts of reality are mind-dependent, like my ideas right now are mind-dependent for me. But much of reality exists independent of human consciousness. That's the ontological realism. The epistemological perspectivalism is, but all human knowing, and that's all the kind of knowing humans have, is human knowing, is always conceptually mediated, historically and culturally located, so it's relative in that sense. Absolutely where there's no non-relative understanding of reality. However, the judgmental rationalism asserts that nevertheless, we can, not all claims about what's true, about what's real, are equally plausible. We can use reason and evidence to make judgments between understandings of things. Now, we can't always get down to this is the right one and everything else is eliminated. A lot of times our judgmental rationalism says, well, four possibilities could be the case and we just don't really know yet or never will know. But it basically averts the idea of from perspectivalism, where some people want to go with perspectivalism, which is it all depends on your view, it's all relative, you can come out anywhere, if that's how you see it, then that's good for you, etc. So that's where critical realism wants to go. Some versions of sort of scientistic positivism will replace epistemological perspectivalism with epistemological realism and say, no, we can know, I'm looking, I'm seeing, we just know this, you know, it doesn't have an appreciation for that. So other positions will sort of put different combinations either. That's where critical realism is coming from. The important thing in critical realism that matters for my argument, however, going back to the first thing I said, is that reality is understood of consisting of a whole lot of entities. I know that this language seems a little static, but actually it isn't, because all those entities are understood as existing as a result of ongoing dynamic process. So everything is in motion, but through the fact that everything is in motion, entities come through emergence to have reality. Reality consists of a whole immense range of entities that exist at multiple levels or dimensions. It's not spatial levels, it's sort of dimensional levels. And those entities, by virtue of what they are, in their nature, they possess certain capacities and properties and characteristics and features and limitations, that is, incapacities, and also tendencies, that their causal capacities have certain tendencies. It's not that they can do everything, it's that they typically head in certain directions, though not in any deterministic way. And so I bring those sort of glasses or understandings of how reality, I think, works to bear on this question of are humans by nature religious, and I make an argument that's something like the following. Humans are not by nature religious in the sense, or naturally religious in the sense that everyone is religious. Obviously, that's not the case. Or that non-religious people are somehow desperately working to suppress or purge from themselves something that's always on the surface and about to explode like a volcano. You know, people are able to carry on their lives for generations, it seems, perfectly not religious, and that's fine. But there is some sense, and same thing with cultures, but there is some sense in which what we're calling religion, or what I'm defining as religion following Riesebrot, is part of the nature of things. It's just part of the human reality. And so I don't even, as a critical realist, I don't mind saying nature at all. I know some people don't like that for somewhat understandable reasons, but it's not just experience, because that's just phenomenological. It's the nature of things is where I would like to go in a stronger argument. In the sense that it is part of human being that human beings have universally certain capacities. Which tend to lead toward being religious. Though, now, another part of critical realism is many of the features and capacities and tendencies of entities, they're essentially potentialities. They're not automatic. They're not determined. They don't have to happen. Many things that humans can do, they don't do. All of these things have got to be triggered by contextual, environmental, experiential factors that make something happen, that enact something, that turn a potential into an actual, that allow a capacity to engage a mechanism that produces some outcome. And so the crucial thing is, things can be real even if we don't see evidence of them. Causes can actually be operative even if we don't see variants. This is a hard thing for a lot of sociologists, who variables-oriented sociologists, cannot imagine something could be real if empirical variance isn't observed. But critical realism just says, well, that's preposterous. There's all sorts of causal mechanisms. There's all sorts of powers at work in the world that don't necessarily give rise to empirically observable variance, sometimes because other causal powers are pushing back in an opposite direction. Those are two causal powers that are neutralizing. It doesn't mean there's no causal powers happening. So it really depends on sort of a larger background framework of understanding what's real, when causes are at work, when mechanisms are actually operating. So critical realism enables us to see things can be real as part embedded in as constitutive of reality, even if they're not empirically observable. And that's sort of the hinge of my argument that non-religious people are naturally religious in the sense that they have as part of their being the capacities, the potential mechanisms, and the tendencies, once those capacities are triggered, to become religious, to act religious, to believe religious, to practice religion, to engage religion. Now, so I distinguish in the paper between capacities, and that's very simple. That's things like capacities that aren't necessarily particularly religious. They can be mobilized to be religious, but many of them are simply capacities for belief, identity, commitment, memory, creativity, envisioning the future, understanding causes and consequence. Whole sets of things that human beings are naturally capable of doing, and only in pathological cases do we lose those capacities, that go into being religious. But those don't necessarily have to turn into religion, so to speak. They can be used for all sorts of things, like getting university degrees or living as any life project. But there are certain tendencies embedded in the human nature, I think, that do guide, when they're triggered, when they're in the right contextual situation, the right environment to pull them together, do lean them in the direction of religion, do have a sort of a natural religious bent that is, again, practices on the premise of superhuman or superempirical powers, etc. So what are those tendencies? So here I'm distinguishing capacities and tendencies. So once the capacities get triggered and activated, there are certain tendencies that sort of give them a trajectory toward what we call religion. So the tendencies are four in my paper. The first is that the humans are in a certain epistemic condition that I argue in my book, Moral Believing Animals. We're not fundamentally knowers. We don't have indubitable certainty based on universal foundations, that we simply just know things absolutely. In the last analysis, everything we know is built on things we believe. And so that doesn't guarantee that anyone's religious, doesn't mean anyone has to be religious, but it puts us in an epistemic condition that makes religious believing not fundamentally different from all the rest of the believing we do. It's not that counter certain secularization era understandings of being secular, namely, the secular is the default natural position of human beings, and it's an unnatural thing for people to have been distorted into superstition or something, or they some irrationality, something they have no good reason to believe. Everybody's in the same boat when it comes to this sort of epistemic condition. So that doesn't that's almost a pre-tendency. It's not necessarily a tendency, but it sets up to move in the direction of religion. The second is the capacity to recognize and desire to solve problems. This goes back to Riesebrot's theory. He's very strong on why do people engage in practices that make reference to or communicate with superhuman powers? It's because they have problems. Ultimately, it's because they have there's a problem. They perceive a problem. They experience a problem. And that could be everything from my daughter is sick to I don't want to die and have my existence end, and a whole range of things between. Just as a parenthetical side note, in Miami we had this really interesting discussion, and Nancy raised a point, which I'm sure she'll raise later, so I won't preempt her, but whether sort of awe and beauty, how that fits into this, and whether we should conceptualize the lack of awe and beauty as a problem. That is, in other words, I think we need to think about Martin's theory in not too instrumentalist terms, like I want to find a parking space, I want my daughter to be healed, I want, you know, what I want my whatever. Some of the problems we might conceive of as more is not quite so instrumentalist. So, but that I'll say I'll let Nancy. I don't want to steal Nancy's thunder on that. But anyway, humans have, in a way that I think we have the best evidence to believe, in a way that no other animal on this planet has, the capacity to run into problems, complex problems, difficult problems, to suffer from those problems, to wrestle with those problems. It's not just that, oh, I am being chased by a tiger, now I'm being eaten alive. I mean, that's a problem. But humans have a whole range of complexities of other sorts of problems, partly because we are not only conscious, but we are self-conscious. We are not only aware, we are self-reflexive. We can just continually fold back upon ourselves, and that there's a great book by a Wake Forest psychologist called The Curse of the Self, which I think explores a lot of this very nicely. Humans have problems. Part of it is we're very good at imagining the future. So our capacities for things like creativity and imagination, which have lots of wonderful outcomes, can also have a sort of a dark side, and so we can anticipate all this horrible stuff that could happen or will happen. So the second tendency is we know we have problems and we want to solve them as much as we can. We're not just fatalistic about problems. And given the human condition, we hit very clear, soon walls with regard to solving our problem, meaning our capacity to know our problems and to want to solve them far outstrips our ability to solve them. And so whenever there's a context that says a superhuman power exists that might be able to help you, there's something embedded in the whole human condition which finds that appealing. Unless that's counteracted by other causal forces that are triggered and brought to bear that neutralize that. The third, and here I do go back and appeal and sort of pull some of what the Andy Greeleys and Daniel Bells have argued, and that is the third tendency is our existential condition as humans to tend, not deterministically, but to tend to think about or to wrestle with, even if not in a highly cognitive sense, what Brad Gregory calls life questions. I mean, the typical way it's put, I don't really like it this way. Why am I here? Where did I come from? Where am I going? That's one simple way to put it. But, you know, what is life? What am I doing? What is this? Why, when I get up out of bed in the morning, if I have a bed, what ought I to do and why? And then that concatenates up to really big questions, you know, what is good and bad? What is moral? And why do I think that? Now, I think it's possible to disagree a lot on the how long the leash is that human beings have, so to speak, from these questions. In other words, Some people might say, most people don't wrestle with that stuff. That's the stuff of intellectuals. You're overestimating, you're projecting onto people the extent to which they worry about these things. I find that that's probably the case. People like Daniel Bell would say, yeah, but they come around. Every time you turn a corner, they're facing you again. You might say, I don't care about these things until somebody in your immediate family gets cancer or whatever. So that I'll be agnostic and say, that's an open question about how tightly we are connected to these questions and how much we can let them go. Or whole cultures could say, whatever, que sera, et cetera. I think that's part of the tendency baked into the natural human condition that leans people in the direction. That trajectorizes, so to speak, people's natural capacities in the direction of religion. Finally, the tendency I talk about, the fourth, is the human moral condition, which is, it's just part, unless, except for strong psychopaths, it's just impossible for humans to not live in a morally oriented space. I'm just drawing here on Charles Taylor and so on. And you just can't escape, and even attempts to say that's not true end up reproducing and providing evidence that that's the case. So I've argued about that in the Moral Believing Animals too. So these four tendencies baked into the human condition, so to speak, I think, when many of the capacities of human beings are activated or triggered, strongly tend, though not in any deterministic sense, to push people in the direction, or to draw people in the direction of religious practice. And then basically what I argue about religious freedom, this part was a little more post something, I don't know what, but about a right when I was sitting down to write this, Timothy wrote me and said, now remember to have a couple paragraphs at least about religious freedom at the end. I was like, oh yeah. So I haven't given as much thought to that as the main body of the paper, but I do think there's a connection there. I do think I'll be interested in hearing your thoughts. I think it's probably impossible to make the link between is religion natural and religious freedom without some account, which I don't get into here, of what constitutes and fosters human flourishing. Because as you said, I am by nature all sorts of things that I would like to get rid of. Just because something is natural doesn't mean it has to be endorsed or cultivated. I think to get there, we need some serious account of what is human flourishing all about, what promotes human flourishing, and what gets in the way of human flourishing. Now, one of my arguments here is that whatever you think of religion, per se, sort of the metaphysical or truth claims, I think it's empirically the case that for states to, because of everything I've just said, that for states to suppress religion, or suppress religious freedom, either by trying to get rid of all religions or by trying to channel everybody into one religion, or a fewer number than their consciences, I'll use that language, would allow, the states ultimately have to start to engage in various forms of symbolic and physical violence. And I take it, symbolic we can argue about, but I take it that states using physical violence to get their citizens to do things that that violate their consciences or that they seriously don't want to do, in most cases, though not in all cases, works against human flourishing. And the not in all cases appeals to a sense of human flourishing. That is, in some cases, you say, if the state doesn't intervene here, it will destroy human flourishing in a much more serious way than if the state didn't intervene. So, which is to say, I haven't engaged the question of flourishing, but I think that's a piece that needs to be brought to bear here to make an argument fully add up. So I have two of three pieces here to make it work, but we have the rest of the day to sort that out. So that's the kind of argument I'm trying to make here. I will leave undiscussed, the part that I pulled out of here, because I don't want that to take any of our attention until we've discussed the rest.
Thank you, Chris, very much. Mm-hmm. Thanks very much. Well, we have a little time to just have a little bit of discussion, but I don't want us to take that too far, because we want to hear from Phil to continue to set the stage for the conversation. But if anybody has some quick, relatively quick questions or comments to make, that would be absolutely perfect. We have a little bit of time. You were admirably brief.
Good.
So we have some time for that. Yeah, Phil.
Yeah, so one of the things I was struck by in reading your paper and hearing your comments today was the fact that
the tendency towards religiosity actually seems to arise, not strictly speaking, out of a set of capacities, but out of a mismatch between capacities and aspirations. So it's, you know, it's precisely our epistemic aspirations versus limitations, our existential aspirations versus limitations. And I think actually that you could probably extend this point to all four of the things that you identify in your paper. So. You know, the sort of existential condition about, you know, the need to address life questions, right? I mean, there's also a sense in which this leads to a certain kind of humility and sense of dependency. Similar thing could be said about sort of moral condition, right? I mean, we have this need to make strong evaluations, but at least certain religious ethics, you know, I mean, require us to refrain from making very fast judgments. Anyway, just some quick thoughts, though, that it seems to me that if you were really describe it, it's not, strictly speaking, capacities leading mm-hmm. to tendencies, but a mismatch between capacities
right.
and aspirations.
No, I agree. That's a good point. I could draw that out more. Actually, in my book, What is a Person?, I argue that the origin of social structures is this sort of mismatch between what we can do and what we can't do. Our capacity to imagine and to accomplish, and not to accomplish, our capacity to imagine and to project far beyond our ability to pull it off. And so therefore we need to construct these stable sets of relationships to make things work. So yeah, and that, I think that connects back here.
I was struck by the sentence when you said that certain in our cultures appear to be quite secular without immediate apparent damage. Take it the word immediate to make quite a lot of work there, because we were back with the question about the sociobiological question about genes voting cultural deletion. And the question is, you mentioned just now, Jim, how long is the leash? Because I would wonder actually whether in fact cultures could flourish over a period without there being damage. And I mean, I would think that the cracks are beginning to show in a lot of European countries. So, I mean, that's perhaps an empirical question. But just because people are happy at the moment doesn't mean that 30, 60 years ahead they will be.
Yeah, which is what I try to raise in the tacked on part
right.
at the end.
Yes.
I agree with you that word is carrying a lot of weight, and by it I mostly want to acknowledge some social scientific humility that we're... all we have is the evidence we have so far, and we're talking about things that require more evidence, and so we have to just acknowledge we don't entirely know yet, which a lot of social scientists don't entirely do. They want to be able to say, well, over time we could prove wrong. My observation is that people's reading of the preliminary evidence is conditioned not insignificantly by their normative commitments. That is, people who want to think that you have to have religion for a functional society are more in tune with the dysfunctions of societies in low religion cultures than those who don't. And vice versa. And the very definition of what's functional. I mean, some people will say, you know, what counts as a problem in society itself is defined in part by people's positions on these matters. So for some people will seem like breakdown, for other people seems like the height of individual freedom. Yeah. Yeah.
In the position, and I assume that it's purposefully, whether we are starting with individuals, or when you talk of humans, you assume that individuals are always embedded in social groups.
Yeah.
And therefore the question is, ultimately is the fundamental sociological question, right? Whether you can ever begin, whichever capacities, whichever tendencies individuals have by nature, the actual actualization would always be made possible only by their being in social groups.
Absolutely.
And this is, of course, the question of religion. I mean, we'll get into this issue later when the discussion we had about the two sources of religion. One is, of course, the individual capacity by nature to be individually religious, self-transcendence. But ultimately, and this is the source of the sacred, this is the Durkheimian notion that ultimately it's from the group that comes. And I think that this duality of human nature, which this is the title of Durkheim's, the dualism of human nature, has to be somehow get into your paper. Mm. Otherwise, I mean, you are not somebody who begins with the individual.
Right.
And so if you want to make your argument seriously, you have to discuss the dualism of human nature here, the biological, individual, and the social.
Yeah, that could be. The way you've just described in terms of potentialities and actualities, I completely agree. The line that I want to hold against is a stronger social constructivism, which will want to say humans are the constructions of their societies, because I think whole sets of things are just biologically, now probably around this table we're all aware of this, but in sociology people can go over cliffs. So, you know, and some people think, well, Durkheim in that very essay said, yeah, I mean, humans are basically lumps of flesh, and it's society that turns them into what they are. And I just think that's too strong of a business, so. Okay, but yeah.
Yes, please. Yes, thank you very much for a very thought-provoking paper that gave me a lot to think about. And I just wanted to ask you up front if you could make something a bit clearer to me. On two occasions, I think it's the first page and page 18, you make an important demarcation between your critical realist stance on the one hand and then two alternatives that you want to discard. The one you spoke about a bit in detail, which would be positivist empiricism. And I think one could easily see how unproblematically that would not help us much further in the conversation. But then also you mentioned postmodern deconstructionism. Mm. And that remains more underdeveloped in the paper, as it were. And to the point that I'm wondering why you would need that demarcation at all. Because your argument is much more differentiated than I'm now summarizing it. But prima facie, as some kind of unreconstructed postmodern deconstructionist, if you like, I was thinking, well, you know, if you're making the case for a certain understanding of religion as natural to human beings, at the same time emphasizing that when we base this on a critical realist epistemology and ontology, we're talking about entities that are not static, but that are basically part of processes from which they emerge. Or we're speaking about tendencies that rely on capacities that are not automatic, but that need to be somehow culturally, historically triggered, whereas that's the constructionist argument. Or when you say, well, there's a strong trend, but not one that is deterministic in any sense, then my question would be, well, you know, how far does that perspectivalism in fact move away from, let's say, the deconstructionism taking into account its further genealogy, right? Meaning like Nietzsche and what have you. Because do I understand you correctly that you say, well, your argument would allow us to speak of religion as natural to human beings, but it would not necessarily allow us to speak of religion being intrinsic to human nature, because you have qualified the concept of nature so much that I'm almost, you know, inclined to say you have offered us, which may be useful, a more robust metaphorics, more robust than, let's say, you know, the perspectivalisms that you clearly don't like, which would be more, you know, on the side of textuality or the semiotics or the symbolic, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a metaphorology nonetheless.
Okay.
Which would not allow one to plausibly invoke the intrinsic natural. You have given us an expanded version of construction and convention. But
so I guess my answer would be I'd need to hear more about what you mean by intrinsic. But as far as your larger question, obviously the label postmodern deconstructionist is an enormous basket and includes everything from really helpful, insightful, useful, smart, I have learned a lot from, all the way across to lunatics. So, and so I'm doing some symbolic violence to them by including them all together. But there are a number of things, at least about the parts that I have in mind when I write this, that I want to be distinct from. One is any version of that that has a strong, well, what critical realism wants to say is even though reality is not static, it's dynamic, it's stable. There's a stability in its dynamism. That is, there's a stability in the reality of this table, even though this is just so much stuff and energy in motion, I suppose, if I was a natural scientist. So it's not static, like just like fixed objects. Everything is exists by virtue of interaction and motion and energy, but its existence takes on forms often, not always, but often, that are really highly stable, and so therefore give us a way of understanding that's the way things are indefinitely. That's the way things are for as long as it concerns us. That's the nature of things. So that's why I am happy to say human nature, but also to say, before the Paleolithic era, I have no idea what the, you know, but I think it's pretty stable since at least the axe. So, for a defined, it's not eternally this is human nature, but for a defined period of time, it's stably this way. Against that, I read a lot of the postmodernists as wanting to go in a much more reality is fluid and it's linguistically constructed and people can sort of reconstruct who they are, right? Not just their social identities, but essentially their selves with the use of language and symbolic presentation and so on. And I just think against that, I want to say, no, humans live in a nature, that is really constraining and really enabling and really directing. And so part of my agenda is to get sociologists to take nature more seriously, both bodies, brains, all, you know, and materiality of context. And that goes back to what Phil said about the incredible limitations, but also capacities that are always crunching up against each other. That's one piece of it. There are other parts of it that I think I spell out in What is a Person? But in the, I wouldn't say that critical realism wants to eliminate positivist empiricism or postmodern deconstructionism, but it wants to do, without being sort of a let's mix it all up in a blender, it wants to say, look, these different positions have insights that are truthful about how things work, but as they've formulated it, it's not adequate. But we need to reformulate insights from different traditions into a new coherent package. And so there's much in postmodern relativism I want to draw upon against scientific positivism. And there's also some in pieces of scientific positivism, namely, sociology is a science. Science is about explaining things, and explanations have to do with causation. Now, I have a lot of colleagues that say, you know, I'm not going there. But that's what I'm more scientific now than I've ever been in my life, scientific in that sense, pro-science in that sense. But that I get from certain things that I want, that I don't want to accept their package, but I take pieces of it out of it. So I'm not sure I've really answered your question, but the, those are similar thoughts.
We'll take one more question before we have the break. I didn't know who had their hand up from that far.
Go ahead.
David.
Yeah, I think that we need to have a discussion precisely on your last point about nature, human nature. I would suggest the following to you. I think one of the problems of using a term like nature, let alone more human nature, unless qualified enough, I would suggest how I think you're qualified, is that you are asking those whom you're talking to buy into an entire metaphysical scheme, which talks about nature, natura with a capital N, and therefore, in a very Aristotelian sense, and how the Stoics as well, is how does this human nature fit into this whole cosmic setup, which requires a good deal of metaphysical argumentation, much of which I think is after Kant beside the point. I think what you mean by nature, and I think a better use of it, is what early modern philosophers referred to as the status naturalis, that is the natural state, which means the human condition as what Oliver Wendell Holmes referred to as the can't helps. In other words, nature is not the conditio per quam, not the overall explanation, ground, etc., but it is the conditio sine qua non, it is that without which our discussion of the human condition simply loses any coherence. It functions like more like a Kantian a priori, perhaps. I think that in that sense, you get much more out of it. And I think that actually that this is suggested by the quote of local reference into Canada's still leading philosopher, Charles Taylor, the notion of the strong sense or strong criterion of evaluation, the quote that you do on page 16 here, the making of strong evaluations, et cetera, that this is something without which nobody is engaged in serious human discourse. And I think that because of that, I think that the whole question of cultural relativism is largely overblown. If we're dealing with religious freedom, and if we're dealing with specifically the opposition to religious participation in the life of the body politic in secular societies, then the chief enemies are such people as radical feminists, radical environmentalists, whatever, who are anything but relativists. They have absolutes. And then the question of discourse is determining what is a legitimate as opposed to an illegitimate absolute, but not dealing with people who claim that there are no absolutes at all, which I think can largely be shown to be circular. So as I say, I think that question of human nature, I would suggest right from the beginning that you adopt a much more minimalist notion of human nature, so that even if you have a metaphysical picture in the background, you do not require that as a precondition for that which you're doing. It might be that to which you aspire, it might be your telos, but not its explicit presupposition.
So there's two ways to think about that. One is strategic, and that is, if I want to be effective in persuading people, how should I frame this? The other is the actual position. What do I really think? That may be true on a strategic level, but I take what I learned from Charles Taylor about sort of the phenomenological epistemology that, look, if we can't live our ordinary lives without reference to something, science has no good reason to jettison it from its vocabulary. I take that to be a really helpful way of understanding what gets included in our discussion, what's allowed to sit on the table.
But that's precisely as a conditio sine qua non. It does not require a buying into a super metaphysical notion of nature, which
might very well be your ultimate position, but something that you don't have to argue for or even regard as some kind of hidden premise. So it's more
right.
strategic because you've got to persuade yourself before you persuade others.
Okay, so I take that as a tool, as a helpful epistemological way to advance. However, my understanding of critical realism and my own approach in it is actually countercultural or a very strong position on a lot of moderns have wanted to proceed as if we can set aside ontological, metaphysical questions. And critical realism basically says, that's impossible. I'm not the one doing the smuggling in. It's other people that deny it are the ones who are doing the smuggling in of their ontological and metaphysical assumptions. And so I don't mind being the one who's coming in asking people to buy into more, because I think that we need to have that more, and people should just own up to it and say, here's where we are.
The point is that by using a term like nature without in what I would consider to be a maximalist sense, is not only you're requiring people to affirm that there is ontology, you're asking people to affirm to a particular metaphysical form of that ontology, which I think is problematic philosophically, let alone rhetorically.
Okay, that may be, and it'd be worth discussing. I should also say, one of the reasons I threw in the one paragraph and did nothing with it about all this needs to be said in historical context is that I realize when you say nature, people are automatically thinking, oh, you believe in original sin, or, I mean, it's fraught with so much luggage that it has to be sorted out, even at just a purely associational level. But I understand you mean more than that.
Atheism, apostasy, and Scandinavian culture from a sociological perspective. He has a virtually brand new book, very pertinent to today's topic, called Faith No More, Why People Reject Religion, with Oxford. Also a book, Atheism and Secularity. Another book, Society Without God, What the Least Religious Nations Can Tell Us About Contentment. Phil's been extremely productive in the last couple of years. You can imagine, judging from the titles of his books, Phil doesn't quite agree with everything Christian Smith has just said. Phil, interestingly, I think will have a lot to say both about the relationship between religion and what we've been calling human nature, as well as the relationship between religion and what Chris talked about at the end of his remarks, namely human flourishing. What's the relationship between both of those ideas? I don't know exactly what Phil is going to say, but again, I don't think Phil will agree 100% with Chris. It's safe to say.
Thank you.
So
he should be able to. I mean, it should all fit
why
together.
Why wouldn't he? thanks very much.
Oh, thanks, Tim. I appreciate it. Thank you all. It really is an honor to be asked, and I had actually forgot about that email exchange. It was quite fun, and it was so nice to be able to say, to tell Rodney Stark exactly what I thought of him, and, you know, securing my job. I didn't have to worry. Oh, yeah. He's hysterical. And thanks, Kyle, for really all the arranging and help, and just, it's really, really, I feel very privileged and honored to be here. I really mean that. And I thought, you know, this is tough, and I kept thinking of Stanley Milgram's obedience experiments, because proximity was a huge factor. You know, I thought, okay, if Christian was just over there, I could really skewer him, but you've got me sitting right next to him. You know, in the Milgram experiments, you know, when people were out of sight, they really revved up the shocks, but then they tried it in different ways, and then in some points they had to sit next to their victim and place their arm on the, and people couldn't do that. So I had no idea what to expect. I didn't know a roundtable, so I thought, oh, you know, Christian will probably come up and speak, and then he'll sit down somewhere, and I can just sort of avoid his presence as I. But that isn't the case. I've never had to give a rebuttal like this with my, with the person sitting right next to me. So we'll see how I pull that one off. I also should mention that I've discussed a lot of this stuff with some of my colleagues, Frank Pasquale and Luke Galen and also Ryan Cragen, and I just wanted to put their names up there because they did help me formulate a lot of this. I've never met Christian, but I... Chris or Christian?
Chris is fine.
My whole paper, as I'm writing my notes, I had Dr. Smith, Professor, you know, I didn't know. So, Chris, I've used your books, obviously, in my classes for years. I often talk about you as the model of how to do sociology, if not sociology of religion. You always present things. You have your data. You have your interpretations. It's all so clear and wonderful, and you write so nicely and clearly. And I would say, like, speaking, you know, like, you're kind of like the anti-Rodney Stark in terms of tone. I mean, you're gentle, you're subtle, you're gracious. I mean, it's so I really and I felt like that as well today. And you know, it was tricky because I read the paper the first time. I read it through. And I thought, oh, it's so sensible. Sure. Well, if you put it like that, of course. And I thought, oh, I've got nothing to say. And uh-oh, you know, this is going to be difficult. And then I read it a second time, and I thought, I can't believe he's saying this. And I suddenly had this real visceral, almost hostility to what you were arguing. And I, this is nuts. And then I woke up this morning thinking, maybe I totally missed it, and I don't even know what I'm talking about. So we'll see what happens here. I found the paper to be thoughtful and rich and engaging, and I also will admit at times a little bit hard to follow. I'm just going to say right now I'm not a philosopher, and I found the whole section on critical realism totally over my head, and I tried it two or three times and then decided I should check Facebook or something. I just couldn't quite grasp the critical realism perspective or approach. There was a lot I agreed with in the paper, as I said, a lot that I found sensible, if not insightful. There were certain things that I agreed with, sort of, kind of, not sure. And then, as I said in my second reading, I realized there were things here that I strongly disagreed with, if I'm understanding you. I may not. I may be missing the point. But from what I get from my reading of it, there are some things that I found really troubling as a social scientist. So how do I proceed? Perhaps the nice and proper thing to do, the polite thing, and I like Christian a lot, and we have a fondness for Thai food, and I'm sure, I mean, maybe I should just sort of highlight the things that I think are insightful and helpful and all the things that I think are well articulated. But I don't know, maybe I was invited here to be to give a rebuttal, to be a, you know, to be controversial and focus on the things that I disagree with, to give a real counter perspective. And after all, I've been paid, I'm being put up in a nice hotel with a nice bed, and so I want to do the right thing here. I want to fulfill the wishes, but I'm a little bit at a loss. I'm a little confused. What is the right thing to do here? What is the moral thing to do? Should I be kind to Chris? Should I rip into him so that we all have some fireworks here? Now, why is this so difficult for me? Well, I read the last few pages of Chris's paper, and I think I get it. I'm a third-generation non-believer, and thus my ability to navigate morally ambiguous situations is a little bit lacking. According to Chris's theory, articulated towards the end of the paper, I'll get to the other start too. It seems to work this way, if I read it correctly. For thousands of years, my ancestors, my Jewish great-great-great-great-grandparents, and so on and so forth, they basically, being religious, accrued all this noble, impressive moral capital, reservoirs of it. And, you know, being that religious essentially means, to quote Chris, going with the grain of the universe. And given that we are naturally religious, my ancestors, of course, were basically doing it right for thousands of years. They were, you know, not having sex during menstrual periods. Of course, women were considered nidah, unclean in Hebrew. They were praying to God day and night. In fact, the men were saying a prayer every morning in which they thanked God for not making them a Gentile or a woman for thousands of years. Good stuff. They were cutting the tips off of their sons' penises with glee. They were teaching their children that the world is divided between Jews and Goyim, and of course, God liked the Jews the best. And they were praying and praying and praying, and you can't imagine how religious they were, and all their praising of God and all of this was sort of creating heaps of lockers full of goodness and morality and right living. But alas, all four of my grandparents lost their faith. They stopped believing in these supernatural or superhuman powers. They stopped keeping kosher. They stopped going to synagogue. And their worship of God and their love of Torah was replaced with a love of nature. Bach, Goethe, Shakespeare, equality, women's rights, workers' rights, human rights, civil rights, and democracy. So my maternal grandfather walked away from synagogue and instead got his PhD from the Sorbonne and went on to write plays and screenplays and novels. My paternal grandfather walked away from synagogue and joined an underground movement for democracy against the Tsar, for which he was imprisoned, and he got out of that. Later, he came to New York and fought for workers' rights in the International Ladies' Garment Workers Union. My maternal grandmother studied modern dance under Mary Wigman until the Nazis came, and then she came to L.A., and my paternal grandmother like to read Yiddish literature and spend time with family. And all four of them were what I would call deeply good or moral people, but not because of any secular ideologies, according to Chris. Rather, they were living off of the fumes of these thousands of years of previous generations. They were like parasites. In fact, that's the exact word that Chris uses. Wait, no, they were actually, on page 27, lethal parasites. Now, my parents, godless and secular through and through, even more so than you could imagine, never mind that they live good, charitable, sociable, and fulfilling lives, they are lethal parasites. So here I sit before you, a third generation lethal parasite. So I am really sucking the last blood of this dying cadaver that my grandparents started killing. And I'm basically living off these last drops, and all I could think was, woe for my children. I've got three kids, and I thought, my goodness, based on this sort of like cultural lag theory, I can only expect in a few years they'll be living in the gutter, biting the heads off rats, throwing rocks at old ladies, wallowing in self-hatred, and choking on the shards of Marilyn Manson records. But I digress. As a therapist once told me, sarcasm is not a good idea. Sorry, Chris, I just had to get that out of my system. Okay, let me stop with the sarcasm and the tongue-in-cheek and try to get. So I can't obviously comment on everything in Chris's paper. There's a lot there, it's very rich, there's so much I was writing in the margins. So I'll just pick the things that I thought were the biggest and we'll see how much time I take. Well, most obviously, Chris wants to argue that humans are somehow naturally, innately religious. And as I said, he does this very gingerly and politely with all kinds of caveats and exceptions, which I do appreciate and I think are genuine. For example, he does acknowledge that not everyone is religious and that even some cultures can be fairly secular. But even though he acknowledged this, he nonetheless is intent on supporting his underlying thesis that humans, as humans, are indeed naturally religious. And I have to say, and Chris acknowledges this, and others have, I mean, anytime I read or hear words like natural when talking about humans or human behavior, I immediately get a little nervous, uncomfortable, if not a little suspicious. And I think, whoa, are we still doing this? Are we still trying to call things natural? Didn't we stop doing that a while ago? And then when I hear words like natural coupled with words like religion or religious, you know, I just immediately think about Pascal Boyer's work, and I just sort of think, well, isn't that kind of where it's at? My colleague Armin Geertz in Aarhus is doing some work on this. So, I don't know, I immediately think, well, if you're going to argue that religion is natural, I mean, don't you mean that it's a byproduct of deeper, more primal standard cognitive architecture? And I know there's a debate about that, but I'm not part of that debate. I'm not a cognitive psychologist. I'm not a Boyer expert, and I know very little about bioevolutionary physiology, cognitive neurology, but that's where I think one would go to if one wanted to show something was natural to humanity. And then I have to admit, when I hear words like ontology, I immediately think I'm in the wrong, at the wrong conference, and I'm not a philosopher, and I in fact think any philosophy that may emerge from my response is going to be extremely pedestrian, and I imagine you're going to be scratching your heads thinking this kid doesn't know much. So I understand my limitations there. I am what I would call a lowly sociologist. So let's consider this this topic. And I have to admit, so when I read the paper, I'm a little bit confused. Like, I feel like it's the general premise is a little bit contradictory, because here's this assertion. I mean, when Chris says that we are naturally religious, you know, on page 2 he says, you know, and I loved the line where you said, I'm trying to get sociologists to take nature more seriously, and you even included the brain. I'm totally down with that. I totally agree. So I think we have a lot in common there. But by natural, you say that on page 2, that which is, quote, essential and universal for all human beings in all cultures, as you say, ever since the last 10,000 years or so. Which, when I read that, I think that means that he's saying that all people everywhere at all times are religious by nature, in essence. On page 10, he says it has something to do with our very ontology. But then on page 11 and 18, he sort of soberly admits, okay, well, many humans, of course, are not religious, and some societies are even quite secular. So right away, I'm like, well, how can something be essential and universal if many people don't exhibit it? Wouldn't, in such a situation, the more accurate, more sensible version of reality be the following? Hey, lots of people are religious, lots of people are not, and lots of people are in the middle. Now, I once was told by a professor that the job of sociology was to take, said something like, you know, to take simple things and complicate them. As I read this paper, I felt like Chris was doing the opposite, taking something very simple, which is there's a lot of religious people out there, there's a lot of non-religious people out there, and there's a lot of people in the middle, and somehow suddenly making it very complicated, where I don't see the complication. Why insist that religion, why on the one hand say, well, not everybody's religious, we know that empirically, and not all, but why insist then that religion is a natural component of being human? And what can this mean? So on page 11, he specifically states what he means by natural. He means that all humans have certain innate features or capacities or tendencies which, quote, under the right conditions, predisposes them to be religious. Well, wait a minute. Under the right conditions is a massive sticking point. Under the right conditions is a lawn sign I would put on my front lawn. That's a huge caveat. In fact, under the right conditions is the only sentiment that I can think of that actually justifies the existence of the social sciences. Under the right conditions is why sociology exists. Under the right conditions is why anthropology exists. This is why I got into this. I mean, under the right conditions, humans are predisposed to infanticide. Under the right conditions, all humans are predisposed to elongate their necks with gold rings. Under the right conditions, humans have a natural predisposition to inflict deadly electrical shocks on captive victims, as 2/3 of Milgram's participants did. Under the right conditions, humans are naturally predisposed towards democracy or to watch reality shows about the Kardashians. In fact, I could just go on and on if that one stipulation of under the right conditions is there. It's why I became a sociologist. I learned a long time ago that when it comes to humans, under the right conditions means that just about anything is possible, let alone imaginable. But let me grant Chris the point he clearly wants to make. That all things being equal, whatever those things are, and whatever equal might mean, people are naturally predisposed to be religious. But I still don't quite get it. I couldn't wrap my brain around it the second time. It felt like a banal truism. I mean, after all, anything that humans do is a result of our human nature. I mean, of course humans have a natural tendency to be religious, or else they wouldn't be, and religion wouldn't exist. Humans also have a natural tendency to make Rubik's cubes, to ponder works of abstract art, to hate abstract works of art, to grow sugarcane, to commit adultery, not commit adultery, to get a rush from bungee jumping, to find bungee jumping abhorrent, to believe in Santa Claus, pierce themselves, juggle, masturbate, not masturbate, watch sports, blow the tops off mountains, etc., etc., etc. I mean, anything and everything that humans do is obviously part of their natural tendencies and predispositions. But the whole point of social science is to understand how social forces can shape, retard, enhance, suppress, stimulate, or mold those predispositions. Now, you might say, well, Phil, we don't find people everywhere blowing the tops off mountains, and we don't find all cultures playing with Rubik's cubes, but we do find religion everywhere in all cultures, and it seems in all societies for which we have records. So I accept that maybe my metaphors and analogies are not exactly correct. So then I thought about dance. My wife's a Martha Graham lover and Martha Graham scholar, and I thought, well, using Chris's theory, we could say that to dance is at the very core of what it means to be human. Indeed, humans have a natural predisposition to dance, and thus to be human is to be a dancer, and to dance is to be in touch with our very human nature. Indeed, we are natural dancers. We find dance in every culture for which we have evidence. Our bodies have evolved to dance. And yet we know that a lot of people really don't like to dance. They don't go to dance performances. They could care less about dancing. And in fact, some people would feel deeply embarrassed and awkward dancing against their very nature. They would feel, in fact, while dancing, to be alienated from their very nature. And there have even been movements throughout history that have tried to suppress dancing, to ban dancing, indeed, to deem it immoral and illegal, something so natural. And so I would never in a million years, well, maybe that's a stretch, I would never think to claim as a social scientist that people who don't dance are somehow living against the grain of the universe or against their very natural tendencies. Rather, I would say, as I said it before about religion, wow, some people are really into dancing, and some people are utterly oblivious to dancing, and some people hate it, and some people are sort of in between, and isn't that interesting? Why are some people into dancing? Why aren't others? But I would never think to argue that dancing was innately ontologically natural and in line with the will of the universe, while non-dancing was then somehow unnatural and going against the grain of the universe. You all know this, but I think it's important to stress that ubiquity must never be mistaken for destiny, especially when we're talking about humans. I mean, slavery has been ubiquitous throughout human history. Does that mean we're bound to it forever? And that non-slaveholding societies are somehow unnatural? Of course not. Non-democratically elected governments has been the rule of thumb for much of human history. We've been ruled by kings and chieftains and warlords for most of human history. So does that mean, you know, non-democratic forms of government are somehow natural while democracies are somewhat unnatural? Who would say such a thing? How about illiteracy? Throughout most of human history, humans have been illiterate. But that was not our destiny. So I find the whole premise sort of troubling, and I have to think maybe I just am not getting it because it just seems so obvious to me. And then it dawned on me that, well, not only is the premise, what I understand of it, kind of a banal truism, but it's deeply problematic as a sociological principle. And so here's what I did. I simply decided to take Chris's own words, as written in his paper, to understand why I was so troubled, and I just started substituting other words for religion. I put in polygamous. It worked really nicely. I put in humorous. It worked really nicely. And then I put in evil. And what I found is I could basically plug in any human activity, any human tendency, any human capacity, and it worked just fine given Chris's model. So for the sake of, I don't know, to make it more exciting, I want to stick with evil. After all, there's ample and undeniable evidence that human beings in all times, places, and societies commit destructive acts against fellow human beings, and that can, if one wishes, be meaningfully characterized as evil. So using Chris's technique, you know, we can politely admit that even though human beings do not always and everywhere exhibit evil behavior, and even though there's a lot of people that aren't acting evil, the empirically undeniable prevalence and recurrence of evil behavior reflects an underlying and essentially evil nature of human beings, or at least a natural tendency to be evil. And we can argue that when evil is not done, this is only because our inessential nature remains untriggered, unexpressed, or suppressed by particular circumstances or environmental factors. So sorry to hammer this home, but I'm actually gonna read several paragraphs from Chris's paper, but I'm substituting evil for every time he had religion or religious. This comes from pages 11 to 12, and listen to how it sounds. This is now Chris's words with me just changing the one part. All human persons are naturally evil, if by that we mean that they possess, by virtue of their given ontological being, a complex set of innate features, capacities, powers, limitations, and tendencies which capacitate them to be evil, i.e., to think, perceive, feel, imagine, desire, and act in ways that are destructive of fellow human beings, and which, under the right conditions, tend to predispose and direct them towards evil. And again, the natural evil of humanity is thus located not in a naturally determined uniformity of empirical evil practices, either by individuals or societies, which is how positivist empiricism would focus our attention. It is instead located in the distinctive inherent features, capacities, powers, limitations, and tendencies of human persons that are rooted ultimately in the human body and the emergent, often non-material capacities derived from the body. And again, human persons being evil by nature in this sense should not be taken lightly. We are speaking here of very powerful causal forces and dispositions that rooted in the very nature of reality and are chronically triggered to operate in human life in a full spectrum of human social context. This helps to explain evil's primordial, irrepressible, widespread, and seemingly indistinguishable character in the human experience. If true, it also suggests that assertions of the essential goodness of human beings are simply not realistic. They are cutting against a very strong grain in the nature of human reality's structure, and so will fail to prevail. And I can't imagine anyone in this room would agree with that last paragraph.
Probably half of us would agree.
Maybe, okay. Fair enough. Oh, sorry, you're right. Indeed, any attempts to deny this evil nature or to curb it or to work against it are ultimately futile because, after all, it is in our nature. To try and stomp out evil, to resist evil, to suppress evil is going against not only human nature, but again, in Chris's words, the very grain of the universe. And all those odd humans who are not exhibiting this evil, well, they must be somewhat unnatural. So, in short, Chris's thesis that religion is natural to human beings is, I don't think, grounded in good social science. But I don't mean to be rude here, but I don't know how else to say it. But to me, it feels like philosophical wordplay. Sorry, Chris. Okay. And to me, the more obvious position as a social scientist would be simply, and one that is extended by the data, and I'll say it again, many people are religious, many people are not. In some cultures, religion is strong and widespread. In others, it's weak and marginal. In certain historical eras, religion's very pervasive. In other historical eras, it's not. And aren't these facts interesting? Why are some people religious and not others? Why are some cultures strongly religious and not others? Why does religion wax and wane over different historical periods? But to try to assert that humans are somehow naturally religious, really? I mean, why go there? What is gained? And maybe this is where my own perspective or values or normative position is gonna come in, but what I'm going to say is what 99% of people who hear this are going to come away with, because I think Chris is very subtle and nuanced in what he means by these things. So I know that Chris, when he says natural, he means something very palatable and nuanced, but I don't think most of us are going to get to hear him explain that. And so most people who take this argument, they're just going to hear this And this is what they're going to get from it. By asserting that religion is natural or that we have natural tendencies, we are therefore elevating religious people as being in line with their very human natures and the universe, while simultaneously denigrating secular people as being woefully and pitifully out of sync with their natures and the universe. Chris's theory thus reifies the notion that religiosity is ultimately healthy, while secularity is in fact intrinsically pathological. Chris's theory celebrates religion thus as an expression of true humanity and castigates secularity as a retardation, obfuscation, or denigration of true humanity. Religiosity is going to thus be constructed as correct existentially, neurologically, and cosmically, while secularity is thus constructed as incorrect, indeed nothing more than lethally parasitic. And I think, with all due respect, this is really bad sociology. I think, although I'm not sure, that it's not very good philosophy. But much worse to me is I think it reveals a real deep lack of imagination concerning the complexities of the human condition. That's the thrust of my main critique. And now I will go on to some finer points. On page 4, Chris says that religion is not fading away in the modern world as a whole. Well, he's correct there, obviously, but also I think he's not quite telling the whole story. In most of the world where people live in really bad conditions, where life is insecure, there's poverty, oppression, where birth rates are the highest. And that is where we find religion the strongest. So simply in terms of birth rates, religion is booming as a demographic reality. But in many parts of the world where the birth rates are the lowest, religion has most definitely been fading in the last 100 years, whether you're talking belief, behavior, or belonging. And I don't know how anyone could argue otherwise. If we look at the rates of religiosity in Canada in the last 100 years, it is plummeting. If we look at the rates of religiosity, either belief, behavior, belonging in Australia in the last 100 years, plummeting. Europe is amazing, as you all know. In Holland, the rates have plummeted. Today, over 40% of the Dutch are religious or non-religious. In Great Britain, nearly half of the population now claim to have no religious identity at all. In Sweden, approximately half of the population self-identifies as secular. As you all know, from other statistics, 61% of Czechs, 49% of Estonians, 45% of Slovenians, 34% of Bulgarians, 31% of Norwegians claim not to believe in God. And I think more to Chris's points, 33% of the French, 27% of Belgians, and 25% of Germans do not believe in God or any sort of universal spiritual life force. Such levels of atheism, agnosticism, or overall irreligion are simply remarkable, not to mention historically unprecedented. Whether we're talking church attendance, Sunday school attendance, belief in the Bible, belief in God, belief in life after death, I think Steve Bruce's latest book drives it home. On every measure, we've seen religiosity in decline in the last 100 years. And even here in the United States, God's country, the percentages are pretty striking, especially from the last 25 years. Back in 1990, 8% of Americans claimed to have no religion, and today it's up to 17%. Now, I know that all of the nuns, N-O-N-E's, are not all atheists and agnostics, but a significant proportion are, perhaps up to half. So this is still an increase of atheism, agnosticism. 27% of Americans claim not to practice any religion, with 22% saying that religion is not a factor in their lives. And in the 1980s, there were twice as many evangelicals among the 20-somethings compared to nuns, but today that's flip-flopped. So now nuns outnumber evangelicals 2-1 in the 20-something category. So it's strange for me when Chris says laudably that we must let the best available evidence determine our conclusions, and yet he blatantly ignores the overwhelmingly strong evidence of secularization throughout many parts of the world. Now, and I appreciate Tim's first quote, and I just want to say, I am not trying to defend secularization theory. I don't think any social phenomena is inevitable. I don't know who would say that. There's Joseph Smith, another Joseph Smith is waiting around the corner, I am sure. I think secularity and sacrilarity, I mean, these things go up and down, and I would never say that we're inevitably going to become secular. I think that's ridiculous, and I don't think secularization is imminent or necessary or inevitable. Who can say? These things come and go. So again, my position is, well, sometimes secularization happens, sometimes it reverses, and that's the complexities of human life. So I would never say we're inevitably going to become secular, but at the same time, I'd resist anyone who says that, you know, we can't become fully secular and that a secular society is impossible. I think that's equally bad sociology. Because I don't believe that religion is some irrepressibly thing that's, you know, natural to the human being. And when Chris says attempts, you know, because religion doesn't seem to be going anywhere, therefore, quote, that suggests that religion is in some sense irrepressibly natural to the human being, but I really do find that a non sequitur. I mean, all we have to do is offer alternative explanations for why religion is not fading away. Why is the only option, well, religion isn't gone, it's not going anywhere, so it must be part of humans' ontological nature. To me, that's just a non sequitur. We can say that, well, religion's not going anywhere because children are socialized and that religious socialization is strong and durable. We could say that the sociological factors that inhibit or gnaw away at religiosity, such as education, existential security, etc., are not pervasive in many places, allowing religion to thrive. We could say that religion and nationalism often feed off of one another. So where nationalism is strong, religion often has a role to play. We could say that for whatever reason, people don't understand scientific explanations of the world or the universe and turn to religion for answers. Now, I'm not backing any one of those, but I'm just saying, like, voila, here's a handful of possible explanations as to why religion still exists other than it must be natural. Again, I just don't buy that. Another point, sorry this is haphazard, but I just have to return to the big questions part of Chris's paper. I spend all I do when not trying to make my wife happy is interview people who are non-religious. That's what I do. I just sit down and I interview secular people from all over the United States, races, classes, and many people from outside the United States. And I think there's a bias here in the assumption that, oh, we all, these questions, these big questions, you know, why are we here? Why get up in the morning? What is the meaning of life? What should I live for? Whether that's all-consuming or just kind of pops up, you can't avoid it, however you want to frame it, the notion, which I think is implied in Chris's paper, is that only religion can address those questions. And I just simply think that is incorrect. Whether or not those are big questions for people isn't the point I'm trying to make. The point is they can be huge questions for people and dealt with in a secular orientation quite easily. In fact, millions of people do this all the time. And the very common reality of apostasy speaks to this. Millions of people who were religious give it up. They become secular in their own life because the religious approaches to these questions don't satisfy them, don't work for them. So these are people who obsess about these very questions and find religion lacking. So I just think that if we privilege religion as the only way to deal with life's big questions, we're stacking the deck here and revealing a real bias that I think is a short-sighted view of humanity. I mean, all one has to do is watch the films of Ingmar Bergman to understand that big questions can be dealt with in a secular manner. And if Ingmar Bergman's too boring, just watch Groundhog's Day, and you'll get a very, very clear understanding of how the big questions of life can be dealt with without any appeal to supernatural entities, powers, or however you want to formulate that. Last quick point. I know I'm shooting, buckshot here or whatever, but I'm all over the place. But I'm a little bit troubled by Chris's insistence that all humans are sort of believers at root. We're not knowers. And so thus, there's really nothing qualitatively different, he says, from religious believing than any other type of human believing. Again, I'm not a philosopher. This is probably territory you cover in your first week of your intro to philosophy classes, but I would argue that there's different kinds of belief, and people can have good reasons for what they believe, they can have bad reasons for what they believe, or no reasons at all. People can base their beliefs on evidence or no evidence or flawed evidence. People can believe things because they have tested those beliefs, and people can believe things that they don't test at all. And I just don't get it. I mean, my belief that I'm losing my hair is simply not the same thing as my belief that my wife is the most beautiful woman in the world, or that it was 72 degrees in Los Angeles yesterday. Or I just don't think these are the same kinds of beliefs. And I think that Chris's insistence that religious belief is somehow the exact same as all kinds of human belief is unhelpful and unworkable. I mean, if it were true that all belief amounts to the same as essential thing, there would never be any way to refute a belief as false. I mean, why do people believe they've been abducted by UFOs? Well, that's no different than believing penicillin cures strep throat. No, it's very different. Why do some people believe that Muhammad rode a white horse through the sky? Well, that's no different than some people believing that rubber is derived from latex. I mean, these are very different kinds of beliefs. And I just saying that there's no difference between religious beliefs and other forms of belief, I think, is incorrect. I could be wrong. And finally, thanks. I feel like I'm droning on here. I was asked to say something about religious freedom. I'm all for it. It's not my area of expertise. I think the founders of this nation got it right in the First Amendment that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. I think this is the best approach to take, that governments should not be in the business of establishing, supporting, or pushing religion, nor should government prohibit, suppress, or seek to abolish religion. But if I must elaborate, these things do come close to home. My children have to watch their teacher lead the class in saying something that says under God every morning, and that is something that I don't like, just as I'm sure a believer wouldn't like it if every morning a teacher had this kid stand up and said, we all know there's no God, let's, you know, say isn't the flag beautiful. Who would want their kids to have to every day have a teacher say, and we all know there's no God, and now let's pledge a loyalty to her. So I don't like it that my kids have to say this. It causes confusion for them. I think it's inappropriate. Well, I have to deal with it. What can you do? So I do think about these things a lot. But I can tell my limited understanding is that, as Chris has already mentioned, that in the countries that limit or restrict religious freedom, these tend to be the most undemocratic of societies and totalitarian and despotic. And the former Albania under Enver Hoxha is my favorite example of a nightmarish society that was hell-bent on destroying religion. Paul Froese's book on the plot to kill God is a wonderful example of showing how heinous atheistic tyrants can be in trying to stomp out religion. And I also see that where religious freedom is restricted, we also find restrictions on women's rights, gay rights, political freedoms, civil liberties, freedom of press, freedom of speech. So it seems to me that those societies that don't allow for religious freedom are at root brutal and repressive. And if I look at the societies on Earth that have the greatest degrees of religious freedom, these tend to be among the more healthy, more democratic societies, often the most secular, ironically, not always. I would also, however, if I have to think about it, I'm not sure that religion should ever trump secular law, particularly in regards to human rights. So this is where I'm always troubled. I mean, when you're doing something in the name of religion, what are the limits? And Chris does mention a few extreme examples, but he seems to imply, well, these are just sort of extreme examples. But I'm not so sure. And I disagree very much with Chris's notion. And I don't, again, I'm like, why even go there? What is gained? He seems to suggest that a society which tolerates religious freedom is somehow respecting human nature. But again, this creates a problem then, because if humans are naturally religious, I would argue they're also naturally secular. And these are both outgrowths of our natural tendencies, to be religious and to be secular. So I would argue that a society which privileges religiosity as natural, again, is somehow going to denigrate secularity as unnatural, and I think that's a very bad idea. So I would rather have a society that respects human freedoms, broadly understood, which would include certain religious freedoms, but not privilege religious freedoms as somehow innate to the human condition, because I'm certain if that is the tendency, then when Rick Santorum does become president, those of us that are not religious are going to be in real hot water because, hey, we're going against human nature, let alone the grain of the universe. So I guess I actually, although I've spent my time disagreeing with Chris, which is sad because I actually think our work overlaps tremendously. I think we probably agree with more than we disagree with, but I was just troubled by the underlying thrust of this paper, which I thought had intrinsic problems. And thanks for listening. And thanks, Chris. Thank you.
What did you really think of it?
Yeah, exactly. This is why I don't go to faculty meetings, because I always say these things to people.
So. Very good. No, thanks very much for kicking off what's going to be an energetic discussion this afternoon. In a few minutes, we're going to have lunch. I know Chris would have many things to say in response, but I don't want Chris to start doing that now. We'll have Chris, right after we have lunch, begin the afternoon's conversation by responding, and then we'll have a collective conversation. If anyone has a couple of perhaps clarifying comments or questions concerning what Phil has to say. We have about 10 minutes before we have lunch. You're welcome to do that. Yes, Roger.
I was interested in the reaction from some people when he read up a bit about evil, because I thought, yes, I agree with that. Evil is part of human nature.
Mm-hmm.
It is a fact. We don't approve of it, but it's there. And if you take that line with religion, it is a fact about human nature, but whether it's a good thing or not is a further question to be talked about.
Indeed.
It is a jump to say it's natural to saying it's good, but just because you don't think it's good doesn't mean it's a reason for saying it can't be natural. So I think one shouldn't run the two together.
I totally agree, and I guess that was my initial point, that anything and everything that we see humans exhibiting is part of our nature. I can't think of anything that's not. I mean, graffiti writing is part of our human nature. I was just, and you're right, I guess I was using evil to sort of be a bit polemical and maybe a bit blasphemous, because the thrust I get from Chris's paper, where he seems to be going, is religion is a good thing. Look at these Scandinavian societies. Well, they seem to be doing okay, but they're living off the fumes of previous generations, which were religious. And so they really, you know, I got from Chris's paper that religion is a good thing ultimately, and a natural thing. So I was trying to say, well, anything humans exhibit is natural, and let's take something that Chris wouldn't think is good, like evil, and plug it into his scheme. I guess that's where I was going. But you're absolutely right. These are two separate questions and should not be confused.
Just on the Scandinavian point, I mean, you were talking about individuals.
Sure.
I mean, a critical realist
would also want to be talking about the structures of society and real structures. So I suppose you could argue from a critical realist point of view that, and a lot of my colleagues are critical realists, so I'm very familiar with all this, that actually the structures that are there are the product of previous generations. And in Scandinavian societies, the structures are still Christian. They'll be eroded, but it will take several generations for that to happen. So the church is still there,
right,
et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is decoupled or loosely coupled with the individuals.
Sure. It's not the different levels, yeah. To be sure.
One of the points in common that you mentioned, Phil, about Chris's presentation was drawing our attention to nature and the question of the nature of human nature and putting the body back into our thinking about religion, the importance of the human response, if we're talking about experience, and things such as emotions and how they relate to beliefs and other aspects there. Could you give us more of your thinking along those lines? It was an important point of agreement, I thought.
I'm not quite sure what you're asking.
Oh.
Sorry.
Well, I think at one point you had said that you applauded Chris's effort to bring the body back to the center of thinking about these matters.
Yeah. I may just be at a much baser level, but I in my studying, I was trained as a sociologist. I think sociologically, but in my study of secular people, as I interview secular people, especially apostates, the more interviews I do, I start to realize that something's going on here other than just social forces. There's something in their brains. There's something in their psychologies. And so just as Chris said, he's more scientific than he's ever been, I'm finding myself more psychologistic than I've ever been before. I mean, I used to think sociology was kind of the only way to understand humans, and now I realize that there is a brain in there. There are predispositions. And so I was just applauding Chris's insistence that sociologists tend to run too far away from that, and in fact, there is human nature at play. There are these dispositions, there are innate features, and we need to give more credence to that. That's kind of what I meant.
Thank you.
Yeah. I wanted to ask, Phil, where do you locate yourself kind of epistemologically, methodologically? Because Chris started his paper by saying you can look at this through a kind of empirical observation perspective, and you could get arguments for on either side of it. Mm-hmm. But then he rejected that method and went on to this critical realist method, which involves a kind of different mode. But it seemed to me that in your entire presentation, as I heard it, you were staying within that first methodology, the empirical observation method, mm-hmm. because you said that, you are taking the nature argument to be one who observes it, you know, everywhere across time. And then you were saying, well, you can refute that by saying, well, it's not everywhere across time. But it seems to me you were just almost totally staying within that world of that kind of method, whereas, as you know, Chris has articulated, then moved from that to articulate a different kind of approach to looking at it.
Thank you. Wow, I actually don't know what I am. I've never labeled myself as such, and I don't get into. I'm agnostic. But I will say this. Like I said, I had trouble understanding that section of Chris's paper. Positivism, empiricism, critical realism, deconstruct. I mean, this is just, it's not, these are frameworks that I just don't apply to much. But I will say.
I think a lot rides on that, though.
Absolutely. And it's probably, it's probably unconscious processes that are at play because I'm not aware of how I'm thinking and how I'm doing it and how I'm forming. But I will say this. As Chris is explaining critical realism here, I'm like, yeah, that sounds good, that sounds good, that sounds good. And then he said one sentence. Things can be real even if they are not empirically observable. And then I just go, well, what, like a Ouija board? Like, what are we talking here?
Like the ideas in your brain right now.
Okay. Okay, fair enough. So that's a realm I just don't go to. To me, it's...
Your values.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that we can't... I don't know. So yeah, I guess I am a positive empiricist. I don't know.
Phil Garskin.
So just two quick thoughts that came out of this latest interchange. I mean, it does seem to me that it's important to clarify that this is human nature, in what sense the human, what is the sort of, so to speak, the semiotic context or the referent for this? I mean, is it animals? Is it God? Is it something distinctive about Homo sapiens? I mean, I think there are, a number of different perspectives from which one could think about this. not necessarily religious. So it strikes me that, we have to clarify then, and we also have to make much more explicit, the kinds of arguments that could be mobilized for talking about human nature as having a kind of a higher claim on our understanding of ourselves than simply sort of brute nature, so to speak, those things that we might have in common with animals. I'm particularly curious as to whether it's possible to make a purely secular, non-theological or non-religious argument in favor of that. That's an interesting question for me. Also want to really thank you, Phil, for just, for being polemical, okay. Because I think that's really what we all wanted. It's a very full-throated debate, so I think it was exactly right. I will say, though, that in a way, I'm not sure you really put your strongest foot forward. Actually, I think, rather than evil, which had a lot of us just nodding our heads around the table, actually. I mean, all the Augustinians here at the table
right.
had no trouble swallowing all of that.
Yeah.
But, I think that really the stronger challenge really for a lot of us is actually the Scandinavian and the European case. Mm. The possibility of a flourishing society without religion, you know, can we really credibly argue that this is just, you know, living off borrowed capital? Is there some sense in which we still want to argue that there's an institutional legacy of Christianity that's baked into the institutions and reproduced through childhood socialization at the level of practical morality? I mean, I mean, those are sorts of argument, counter-arguments that one might mobilize, but I mean, I do think that it raises all sorts of really important questions. And conversely, you know, to be sort of polemical, I mean, if you look at these, kind of standard OECD well-being happiness indexes and so on, you know, the U.S. does not do that well. Mm-hmm. The U.S. does not do that well at all. And, you know, whether this, again, is, maybe this is just a spurious correlation. You know, mm-hmm. maybe, in fact, you know, what's really at odds, you know, for example, this new, the spirit level, this new popularizing book actually out of the UK talking about the relationship between equality and human well-being.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Right. So we can talk further about, you know, whether human equality is in fact itself a kind of a legacy mm-hmm. of the Western religious tradition. Is there really a non-theistic, non-theological argument for human equality, for human rights? I mean, these are also important issues, I think, that need to be out on the table. Okay, so I'll shut up.
And I have a lot to say about all you've said, but we'll wait for it. Yeah.
You know, in terms of the overall the presentation of your response, you responded to points in Chris's paper, but your very beginning was somewhat puzzling. And I might ask a personal question, since you began so personally. Why did you begin by telling us about your parents, grandparents, and then before them, great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents who lived very different kinds of lives? What was the point of that introduction here? And I'll be perfectly honest with you. I will say that as somebody who I think lives a good deal of the way your great-great-grandparents lived. And am I wrong to say that you're speaking of them had a degree of ridicule, if not contempt?
No. Thank you for asking. And I understand that maybe it's inappropriate to bring in personal things, but I like to start off.
I didn't say it's inappropriate. I just want to know why.
Oh, yeah. I think, number one, I kind of like to sort of tell people where I'm coming from, a little bit about who I am, my own positionality. I just think it makes it more engaging and interesting. I like to know where other people are coming from. And so I think that's just an instinct of mine. I don't know if it's a Jewish thing, a Hollywood thing. I don't know what it is, but I just have that impulse. But in fact, my family's trajectory is not idiosyncratic at all. Jews are among the most secular people on earth today, especially American Jews. And that in fact, that trajectory I'm talking about of my individual life story of my parents is for millions of people. And I was actually trying to refute Chris's notion of this kind of, you know, the only way you can have these good, thriving societies is if they're religious. And yes, he says, we may see evidence in Scandinavia, or Jews today, that seem to be moral and okay, but they're lethal parasites, which I just think is really, really unimaginative.
Well, just one closing point there, yeah. In terms, and it's a sociological fact, which I think you as sociologists will appreciate. Approximately, I mean, these are rough figures. In the United States today, or North America, since I live in Canada, approximately 15% of Jews, North American Jews, identify themselves as Orthodox Jews. Mm-hmm. When it comes to those under the age of 35, it becomes over 30%. So therefore, the idea that Jews are becoming more secular, because those Jews who are choosing to remain as Jews, which means marrying other Jews, having Jewish children, and continuing the tradition, however, and many of them come after a hiatus of two and three generations, would indicate that those societies that are interested in their future are those who have continued the lines of ancient tradition.
Indeed.
Time for lunch.